Thank you very much indeed. Having followed that, it was an amazing achievement, and I just want to say congratulations to everybody who picked up awards this evening. I'm absolutely in awe of everything you achieved. Just one other footnote though, I'm not sure if Michael was talking about it or not when he was talking about height. 5'7" and a quarter, which as you all know is above average height for a man in Guatemala. Thank you for asking me here tonight, because it brings me back home. When I say home, I mean I really mean home, because I was born 100 yards from here in the first block of houses that you can see on Catco Road. We played football in the field just over the road there. In actual fact, in my holidays before I started work, I'm not quite sure if I was going to be at university or not, but I wanted to go to work. I helped build this school. I worked here for 3 months part time, so many bits drop off. Probably my fault. And of course now, as you've heard, I present Soccer Saturday at Sky Sports. It struck me, of course, that not everybody would know what Soccer Saturday was. So briefly, it's a football show and the difference in that there isn't any football. No shots, no near misses, no goals. So yeah, very much like supporting Newcastle, really.
I wanted to be a journalist. I didn't go to university. I went and took the job at the Harvard
proved really in some ways that it's one of my messages to you that nothing's impossible. Don't let anybody tell you that you can't do what you're aiming to do. If you want to go and be a doctor, you know, or an actor, or a TV presenter, it's possible, and I'm living proof it's possible, because the kid from Catco or from Riptown State can do it, then any of you guys can certainly do it as well. Look, it needs a lot of hard work, but it needs, as you know, Kieran said, a lot of luck along the way as well. And I labelled all this luck along the way. Having gotten the mail, you know, I went to local radio. I mean, in those days, local radio shows were much easier to come by than they are now, because then there were 10 or 12 people in every newsroom, and now there might be one or two. But my biggest stroke of luck in radio happened on the plane to lower the road there. I'd been in radio for a week, never broadcast. I was playing football over there when I got a message to say, Bernard Jett, our football reporter, is ill. Go immediately to Elland Road to report on Leeds against Middlesbrough, which in those days was a big Premier League match, top flight match. Fantastic. Immediate problem. How do you get to Elland Road? Didn't have a car. I knew someone who did, though. So I rang my girlfriend and asked her how she plans an afternoon shopping in Leeds. And didn't explain that I wouldn't be with her. But even when I got there, you know, things you just don't think about. I got to the ground and I thought, well, that's great, how do I get in? Ticket on the gate, well, which gate? I mean, you've been football matches. And when you got inside, our communication was by a telephone. Not a telephone inside. Where do you find the telephones? I got a lot of help from some senior local journalists, and by Monday, after my match report, suddenly I wasn't just a broadcaster, a radio tease, I was a sports broadcaster, and my career path was set, basically following the morning playing football over the road on those playing fields. And as the years went by, a few years down the line, another stroke of luck, offered a job in London. But wife and I had just moved into a new house, and it overlooked the golf course, and it had two toilets, upstairs and downstairs. And I thought, what more can anybody want in life but two toilets? So I turned the job down. But the luck was that the person who took the job couldn't settle. 6 or 9 months later, they rang me again and said, would you reconsider? And I did reconsider, and I swapped the two toilets, one upstairs, one downstairs, for a one-bedroom flat in the North End Road with the right place outside and a tin shower in the corner and a TV that worked by putting 50 pences in the slot and a punk rock band upstairs. And I'll be honest, I hated it. Hated everything about it in the early days. But you've got to stick with things sometimes, you know, not give up too easily. And after all, it wasn't just me who hated being in London, because some of the time, London hated me as well. I remember one letter that we got, went to my sports editor at the time, asking for me to be removed from the airwaves. And this chap said he couldn't understand my terrible northeast accent. So my sports editor wrote back to him and said, politely, I'm sure you agree that in this day and age, regional accents should be encouraged. Very nice. But our correspondent was determined to have the last word, and he wrote back saying, regional accents should be encouraged. Speech defect should not. So it wasn't necessarily a great success in London, but look, my sports editor eventually, he took me on the BBC radio, and from there I got a chance in television. I went to TVAM, and eventually the old square of the British satellite broadcasting. TVAM lost its license shortly after I joined, and the satellite broadcasting went bust. So they learned the lesson, take Stelling on at your peril. And I was forced to go freelance. And I learned a lesson when I was freelancing, because you know everybody wants to cover in sport, everybody wants to cover football or cricket or golf. You know, you can't get to work. So when people would ring me up and say, we've got some fencing for you to do, I would say, I'm your man, I know everything there is to know about fencing. Or ice skating, athletic sumo wrestling, I'm your man. And I prepped, and prepped, and prepped, and prepped. And I presented a bash show in sumo wrestling with Royal Albert Hall. I presented an entire series of American football, which I knew nothing about whatsoever when they first asked me to do it. American football, I'm your man. And that's the way it worked. And eventually I got a job at Stelling. And again, it wasn't all plain sailing. Because I used to work on a program called Sports Saturday, which was the earlier version of Soccer Saturday. And just as Soccer Saturday, it's a football show with no soccer, the football. Sports Saturday was a sports show with no sports, no one ever. On World Cup final day, Suzanne Dandler, my co-presenter, and I, we played the Subutio World Cup final. That was our idea of coverage. We had a synchronised swimming team in the studio, going to their team, without the water, of course. And I think we hit a new low when, shortly before Christmas, I found myself wearing a Velcro helmet, trying to catch felt balls on it, which were being thrown by the former England cricketer Alan Lamb. And I thought, this is possibly not the direction my career should be going. But as they say, even a blind squirrel occasionally finds a nut. And along came Soccer Saturday. Soccer Saturday turned out to be my nut. It's been going 20 years now. I looked on in awe at some of the appearance awards, by the way, as well. In 20 years, we've done 800 shows, something like that. I missed one when one of my sons was being born. And people often ask me, you know, how do I do my bit, which is the statistical bit, really? You know, how do I know that Dan Eames and Sam Boat scored 57% of Burnley's goals last season, or that Newcastle haven't won a game when they've been trailing at half-time in 82 attempts, or that Newport County haven't won successive games in the league since December, or Fulham haven't won a Middlesbrough since 1984, and the answer is preparation. And it's all of you guys, whichever walk of life you're in, can't beat preparation. 6 hour show on Saturday, I would say we have 20 hours, or I can, 20 hours of preparation for every 6 hour show. Just can't beat it. Prepare, prepare, prepare. And I think wherever you go, some of you guys will know now as well, the ones that are at university already. The other thing I love about Soccer Saturday is it's a chance to show you never forget the roots. You know, we live in the South now, my kids set posh schools in Winchester. But when you guys want to go to university and such like, you find out that they might go to a posh school in Winchester, you know, and you go to English Miles on Capitol Hill or Jester Lane Road. And the kids there have got the same hopes and aspirations, they do the same exams, they've got the same fears as well. And they're no different whatsoever than you are. So when you go out there, shall I loud and proud that you went to English Modern School and you come from Hartlepool and you are going to go on and achieve just as much as any kids from any part of the country. Surely will have come and see this evening. And to a degree, I was thinking to make your own work. But again, half one of my preparation, just prepare to get lucky. I often think, you know, you've got to be prepared to take that chance as well when it comes to work. I look back and think, what if that radio station in London hadn't come back and offered me a second chance of that job? Where would I be now? You know? You also have to, I think, be prepared to start at the bottom, the very bottom. You know, I did it in the tea at the mayor. The only way to get to the very top of the tree is to start at the bottom. Never ever forget that. You know, treat people well on your way up as well. I asked my pal, Chris Kamara, how he would describe my journey from Cat Coda to where I am now. Inevitably, he summed it up in just two words. Astonishing, Jeff. But he always blows his lines, doesn't he? I'm sure your journey's going to be absolutely astonishing as well. Good luck. Grasp every chance you can and enjoy every bit. Thanks.